In simple terms, what is the so-called monster group and what are elliptic functions?
There is no way to explain either of these in simple terms. In non-simple terms, the monster group is, first of all, a group just means the collection of symmetries of something. So if you take a cube, then it's got some symmetries because there are 24 ways you can rotate it. So we say its group is order 24. And the monster group is like that, except instead of a cube in three dimensions, it's the symmetries of something or other in 196,683 dimensions. And instead of having 24 symmetries, this has about 10 to the 54 symmetries. And how it was found, I don't really know. You'd have to ask Robert Grice or Fisher, who were the discoverers of it. The other part was, what is an elliptic function? I guess that there are actually two things which are elliptic functions or elliptic modular functions, and you might actually mean elliptic modular functions. Actually, I can give you a picture of the difference. I've got some actual pictures of them here. There's this really nice book by Janke and Emder. And if you look here, it's got some pictures of elliptic functions. And as you can see, they're sort of doubly periodic, that there's a two-dimensional array of what are called poles. So that's an elliptic function. You come across functions like sine x, which are just periodic. They're just of one period, and elliptic functions are like that even more so. So they have two periods. Elliptic modular functions, on the other hand, if I can find it, look kind of weirder. So here's a picture of an elliptic modular function, which, as you can see, is quite a lot hairier than an elliptic function. And it's the elliptic modular function that turns up related to the monster.
What is the Moonshine conjecture, and how does it provide an interrelationship between the monster group and modular elliptic functions?
So the Moonshine conjecture was started off by John Mackay, who noticed that, I mentioned the monster lives in 196,883 dimensions. And John Mackay was looking at the elliptic modular function and noticed that one of its coefficients was 196,884, so it sort of differs by one. And very roughly, the Moonshine conjecture is to try and explain this coincidence. There's more to it than that, but that's the sort of shorthand form of it. And the first problem is to know whether it's just a coincidence or whether it's meaningful. There are an awful lot of coincidences that are just coincidences. I mean, you can walk down the street and notice, wow, that car number plate has the same three digits as my social security number. That's just meaningless because, if you get a lot of numbers, some of them are going to be the same just by coincidence. At first, people thought this connection between the monster and the elliptic modular function was maybe just a coincidence. But then people like John Thompson looked into it a bit more and discovered that other coefficients of the elliptic modular function were also related to other dimensions that the monster lives in. And so the evidence became sort of overwhelming that this wasn't just a meaningless coincidence. And Conway and Norton came along and discovered that there are other elliptic modular functions that are also related to the monster. So the Moonshine conjecture is trying to explain that all these weird coincidences. This was very bizarre at first because the elliptic modular function lives in an area of mathematics. It's related to number theory and complex analysis and so on. And This seemed to have absolutely nothing to do with finite group theory, which is discussing the monsters. So you have this weird, unexpected relation between two seemingly disconnected areas of mathematics.
And how were you able to produce a proof for the conjecture?
No simple answer to that. Basically, the same as all research, you spend nearly all your time failing, trying out one stupid idea after another. And after 99 stupid ideas have failed, you try another, and that fails too. And you just sort of keep going. And every now and then, you make a little bit of progress. And then the next week, you discover that progress was a dead end, and so on. So it's just a complete mess.
In your opinion, what is the most exciting problem in mathematics which is still unsolved?
Well, the standard answer to that is just the Riemann hypothesis. There's really no competitor. This is the number one problem on every mathematician's list of things they would like to have solved.
And what principles of mathematical thinking do you think would be beneficial for non-mathematicians to incorporate into their everyday lives?
Maybe Bayesian reasoning. So the idea of this is to sort of be consciously aware of the uncertainty in everything. So if you've got some statement, instead of saying it's true or false, you would say, I'm 60% confident this is true. And when you have some more evidence, you adjust how much you believe it is true. So if you find some evidence in its favor, you adjust this to saying, well, maybe I'm 70% confident it's true. So I guess the classical example of this is medical tests. So suppose you have a medical test for some rare disease, and suppose the test gives the correct answer 99% of the time. So if you've got the disease, it will say you have it 99% of the time, and if you haven't got it, then 99% of the time it will say you haven't got it. And you go off and take this test, and it comes up positive. And the question is, what is the chance you have the disease? And most people sort of guess, well, 99%. That's the accuracy of the test. And this is completely wrong. If the disease is rare and only 1 in 1 million people have it, then in fact, the chance that you have the disease is only about 1 in 10,000 if the test comes up positive, which is kind of surprising. I mean, even a lot of doctors get this question wrong, although they're supposed to be trained in this. I think the other answer to that question is, if people are not mathematical, and maybe it's better if they don't try and incorporate mathematical reasoning, because all too often they just get it wrong. You've heard of the replication crisis in science. Well, actually, there isn't a replication crisis in science. There's a replication crisis in various areas like sociology and psychology. And one of the big causes of this replication crisis is they're trying to use statistical techniques that they simply don't understand. So they have this idea that, if p is less than 0.05, then you've got a publishable result, and it's just such ridiculous nonsense. So one answer would be Bayesian reasoning, and the other answer is, if you don't know mathematics, then don't try and use mathematics in everyday life.
Very interesting. What advice would you give to aspiring students who are interested in pursuing a career in mathematics?
Well, again, it depends very much on whether you want to do research in mathematics or use mathematics. In either case, I'd say that the really obvious, really big thing at the moment is to keep a close eye on what AI can do. At the moment, it's not really able to do research. I mean, people sort of claim they've used it for research a bit, but honestly, if you take an AI and ask it some mathematical question, it will bluff. It will give you a plausible sounding answer with all the right buzzwords. And if you look closely at it, it's just gibberish. But you know, in a few years, they're going to get that sorted out, and we'll actually be able to do serious mathematics research. And in a few years more, it's going to be beating all humans. So, yeah, I mean, I think any advice I do on giving on about what mathematics to learn may well simply become out of date when IA really gets going in mathematics.
What do you think is important when teaching mathematics to young people?
So what's important for teaching? Well, I think there are two answers to that, both of which have nothing to do with being young, but apply to everyone. So the first is, it's a waste of time trying to learn anything you're not interested in. You know, don't try and teach mathematics to someone who's not interested in learning it, and don't try and learn mathematics if you don't really want to. The second is that I think the key way of trying to learn mathematics is to forget about proofs or theorems or abstract work and just look at a key example. So every area of mathematics, there are one or two really key examples that kind of catch all the important ideas. So, well, let me give an example. Suppose you want to learn the theory of Lie groups, whatever that is. So a Lie group is a sort of symmetry group. And you could start by reading the definition of a Lie group and reading up lots of theorems about it and studying their proofs. And this is completely the wrong way to learn Lie groups. What you should do is pick one particular Lie group, and the best one might be, say, the group of 2 by 2 matrices of determinant 1. And then you really study that group in detail. And that's the right way to learn Lie groups, because this particular example sort of contains all the interesting properties of general abstract Lie groups, but you can kind of work everything out explicitly.
You just said that if you're not interested in something, you shouldn't bother somebody to learn it. I think every high school student in this world who hates mathematics and hear and listens to this will say to their teachers, "Oh well, I'm not interested in math, so don't teach me." Why should students be interested in learning math?
Well, most students just aren't interested in learning mathematics, and you know, won't really gain anything by having it forced down their throat. I mean, I mean, on the other hand, you do need a lot of mathematics, and I mean, yeah, people are much more interested in learning mathematics when they discover they need it for something. So if you suddenly discover you need it to get a job computer programming or something, that then they actually have an incentive to learn it and are much more likely to do well at it.
Okay, interesting. And it's funny that you mentioned it because I'm a computer science student. And for a lot of my colleagues, it's, and sometimes also for me, math is always the hardest subject. So, what other, except from we have to get this grade, could be a motivator to learn?
Well, trying to get a grade is a very bad motivator. I mean, the best motivator is if there's something else you're interested in, like, you know, someone's interested in physics or computer science or chemistry or something like that, and they start doing computer science or chemistry, and then they suddenly discover they need mathematics to understand what they're really interested in. So maybe the best way would be kind of indirect, that if someone's interested in something that needs mathematics, then that would provide an incentive for learning it.
Okay, thanks for your answer. And one last question. We've already talked about high school students and math. What do you think should be the base level for every single person to understand math? What is the bare minimum?
Well, it just varies so much from person to person, and so someone who's interested in mathematics is going to be so different from someone who really doesn't want to learn it. It's hard to say. I mean, but ideally everybody should learn a certain amount of basic arithmetic and basic probability theory, and you know, there's statistics is much more common these days. Everybody thinks, everybody is put off by the name statistics, which is why all the statisticians rename their subject as data science to make it sound cooler. So, being able to understand graphs and things like inflation would be something everybody ought to be able to do.